The BS Report is presented by Subway. Football season is over. Footlong season is just beginning. For a limited time, get any piled high regular footlong for just $5. Any footlong, just $5. Hurry in, Subway. Eat fresh. Eat fresh. The BS Report is a free-flowing conversation that occasionally touches on mature subjects.
First of all,
this is the BS Report with Bill Simmons.
It might be cool, I don't know. And if it's not, I don't care.
The BS Report with Bill Simmons.
Bill Simmons works for ESPN. He's also named the sports guy, and he writes a comical sports column. He must be a popular dude.
The BS Report.
It's got a real dirty sound, like a rusty steak knife cutting through a well-aged steak.
Now.
Here's Bill Simmons.
All right, I spent last Saturday at the Sloan Conference at MIT, the Sloan Analytical Conference. What's it called, Daryl? What's the exact title?
MIT Sloan Sports Analytic Conference.
Okay, that's run by Daryl Morey, who is the Houston Rockets general manager.
But I do think Dorkapalooza is easier.
Yeah, I dubbed it Dorkapalooza. But anyway, it was, first of all, Daryl, welcome to the podcast. It's about time you came on.
Thanks for having me on.
So you started this conference like 4 years ago, basically getting all the great statistical sports minds together. That's the goal. And you had these panels and people talk about different trends and things that are happening and all that stuff. And this year kind of just seemed like it was a bigger deal this year. You had some heavy hitters there, like Adam Silver was there, David Levy. You had some GMs.
Mark Cuban. But you're leaving out the biggest reason it took a step up. You were there.
Oh, stop it. I did. You put me on the earliest possible panel. Thank you for that.
I've been advised that in the podcast you have to suck up early.
Oh, stop it. I mean, you were never going to be in the podcast because we had decided that it wouldn't be good if anyone knew we were friends. And then Rick Bucher outed us.
Yeah, he took us out of the closet.
It was bad. I mean, it's not like you're giving me inside info. It's just you used to work for the Celtics.
Well, it's clear that no matter what I tell you, it doesn't help since you call Yao Jorge Mariston before the season. So clearly I don't have any influence into what you write.
No, you don't. And if anything, I go the other way and try to antagonize you in the column. We met when you worked for the Celtics, and it was really funny to watch you all of a sudden become a GM. I had been telling people it was going to happen, and everybody laughed at me. And then how old were you when you got hired?
I think I was 32.
32. Now you've been the GM for the last 2 years. So before we get into the whole Sloan thing and the stat stuff, talk about your rise to – I hate rise because it makes it sound like I'm pimping you. Talk about your journey.
We haven't done much yet, so it can't be the rise, I don't think.
Right. But, so we'll say journey. Talk about your journey from the business world to how you got to Houston. Like, just give us like the cliff notes.
Yeah, I'm going to give this short, hopefully less boring version. Worked at Stats Inc. with Bill James, and when I was there, worked with them to start the basketball portion of Stats Inc., which was made famous in Moneyball. I couldn't get a job in sports. I think you had similar struggles, Bill. So I was out of it for about 10 years, but got my break when I was working with a firm who worked with the Celtics owners to buy the Celtics, and came out with them, started working on whatever was important, and pretty quickly figure out sports franchise, all that matters is getting the right players for the right money and hopefully winning the title. And so worked with Danny Ainge, learned a lot from him, and then got my break before I thought I would. I thought I'd get my break probably like this year after the Celtics won the title, but got my break a little earlier to come down to Houston.
Well, there was a voice crying in the wilderness. It was your friend Bill Simmons. I was saying that somebody was going to hire you because that whole stat thing was kind of taken off. And, you know, this actually helped you, and you got hired for the right reasons because I always thought you should have been a general manager. But, you know, potentially somebody could have been hired for the wrong reasons, basically because some crazy owner was like, hey, this stat thing seems kind of cool. I'll just hire one of these guys. But in your case, it kind of worked out.
Yeah, well, it turned out you liked it because we'd run all these fancy models with, Mike Zarin, who I hired there and is doing a great job, and we put these crazy things together, and it would basically agree with you, so you just assumed it was great.
Well, it was interesting because we would arrive at our conclusions in different ways. But as you talked about it in the at the Sloan Conference, that's when it's kind of cool. And you were talking about how you've gotten whatever coaches or GMs or whoever to buy into your data, and it always helps if they have come to the same conclusion that you did, but in a different way.
Yeah, and baseball is much harder because the folks like Bill James and Theo Epstein and Billy Bean, all the smart guys in baseball, it turned out they figured out that coaches should just sit there like trees, and the more they did, the more they screwed it up. They should maybe only pick up the phone to the bullpen once in a while, and that's about it. Everything else, hit and run, stealing, bunting, everything was worse than just sitting around and hoping you hit a home run. So
yeah,
that didn't go over well with the managers. But in basketball, you know, you'd look at it, work hard, and you'd figure out guys like Shane Battier are good players. And that's what coaches have been saying for years. So it ended up being an easier marriage. And, you know, we can do things to help coaches. Like, even though they knew Shane was good, they might not know how good relative to another player or how valuable high efficient player is. They sort of intuitively knew, but they didn't know, should I trade this guy for that guy? It was hard to analyze that in a rigorous way, and maybe with some of the tools we're trying to develop, we get a better shot at it.
And when you were at the Celtics, how long did it take for you to kind of talk Danny into it?
No, he's amazing because he's someone who obviously knows basketball, obviously a big competitor, in addition to that, very intelligent, very open to anything that would give him an edge. And I think you could see that in how he played. You know, if he could get an edge, whether it be taking advantage of a rule or doing whatever it took to win, he'd do it. And I think he carried that into his general managership, as you can see with his great success. And, you know, he was very open to it. And I think, you know, credit to him to say, hey, I'm going to learn wherever I can. I think that's why he's the best in the game and why he'll continue to be great for Boston.
And you mentioned it during the conference, like the thing that you like about Danny is whether he agrees or he disagrees with whatever you're presenting him, he'll listen to it and he'll try to learn from it either way. And if he decides he doesn't like it, he doesn't like it, which that's kind of the way to run a team. I feel like you're trying to solicit as many different opinions and pieces of advice and information as possible. You're processing them. And then you're trying to figure out what matters and what doesn't.
That's right. And I think, you know, where Danny has a lot of strength is I think he's open to new ideas and he's very good at sort of filtering out the good from the bad. And, you know, I think and he'll tell you up front if it's BS and, you know, some of the crazy things we'd come up with, he'd tell us to go back and go back into the closet and work it again because it's not working.
Well, you made the point there in the panel that, you know, this is what's happened with basketball is a lot different than what happened with baseball, because in baseball, it's an individual sport and it's very easy to just accurately say what this guy does, what he can't do. You have all these different formulas and tools that we've created over the past, I don't know, 30 years at this point to kind of measure these guys. But in basketball, so much of it relies on not only who your teammates are, but how you're interacting with them, how you're used, all that stuff. And it's only recently in the last like 5-6 years have you guys kind of figured out, well, maybe this is something that works. Well, maybe we could do this.
Well, I think it'll always be harder than baseball, as you point out, because, you know, in baseball you can do things like, you know, say, hey, what if I had a lineup that had 9 Barry Bonds, and you can sort of look at what that would be. It would be really tough, you know, for the media as a first thing, But in basketball, you know, you can't do something like say, what if I had five Shane Battiers on the floor?
Yep.
Because that just would never work. Or you couldn't have 5 Shaqs on the floor or 5 Yao Mings. It just wouldn't work. So no one's value can be isolated to the individual, because, you know, different types of players work together. So it'll always be difficult. You know, you don't know why. If a guy hits a home run, he hits a home run. If a guy makes a shot in basketball, you don't know if it was a good pick or a good pass or, you know, bad defense or he was in his favorite spot on the floor. There's so many factors that you can't isolate down to the individual.
Would you say the biggest challenge still is trying to figure out how to measure somebody like Battier in a conventional way?
Yeah, I think there are a lot of big challenges. I do think that's one, because as much as the game is a dynamic, you know, players playing off each other sport, I, in my job, have to make moves on individual transaction levels. So a recent trade of, you know, Rafer for, you know, Kyle Lowry, it ended up, it was a three-way, but that was our end of it. Oh, we got Brian Cook as well. But it was really, you know, Rafer for Kyle. You know, Kyle, you know, we have to look at how Rafer works with our players and look at how Kyle will work with them. But there's no way to know that 100%. There's no way to isolate Kyle's contribution, because he hadn't played much to this point. He was a good college player that hadn't really been given much time. So there's really never going to be enough data to have a ton of confidence. So you do have to take these leaps of faith, you know, no matter, you know, just like any other team sport.
And sometimes the situation can really screw up the stuff because, for instance, Jason Kidd has been shooting the three really well since he got with Dallas. And in my opinion, the main reason for that is because they don't really ask him to shoot unless he's completely wide open and it makes sense for him to shoot. Whereas if you look at his, you know, his best 2 years, I thought, were 02 and 03 with New Jersey. So his field goal percentage was way down for those years, and so was his three-point shooting. But a lot of it had to do with the fact that he was the primary guy in that team, and he's taking shots at the end of the shot clock, and he's taking shots maybe he doesn't like. Whereas in Dallas, the team is kind of built for him to succeed statistically a little more. You know what I mean?
See, I support your campaign for a GM job, because I mean that's basically the kind of analysis we do. It turns out Kidd's actually always been a pretty good open spot up shooter.
Right.
It's just he would always take more shots because he had to be higher usage. But in Dallas, they got Nowitzki, they got Jason Terry, they got Josh Howard, they got other high usage guys. So Kidd, who has a lot of Battier qualities, actually he's got a sense of what's the best shot on the floor, and often in the past it was him. But on this Dallas team, it's going to be Jason or it's going to be Dirk. But if he's got a wide open spot shot, he knows that's a good shot for him. So, yeah, when we guard Dallas, we wish we could leave Jason alone, but you can't. The teams that rotate off of him and leave him, you know, Nate wide open like Rafer, they'd used to leave Rafer for our team. That's not a good choice for the defense. So. No, that's exactly right. And one of the things that we do, and I know a lot of other teams do, is and you know, sort of more old school GMs do intuitively and probably do it better than we do, is they sort of can picture that guy in the role they're going to be on your team. And we've got some data that can help do that. But really, it's, again, using your intuition along with some data to hopefully make the right decision.
Yeah, when Cleveland traded for Mo Williams last summer, I always liked him because I thought he was just a good shooter. I love having a great free throw shooter. I always think that's underrated. That's why I wanted you to get Korver last year, because I just think you have that end of the game guy who shoots 90%. That's going to help you.
We got Brent Berry this year, so
you got Brent Berry. But you know, I didn't know any of this stuff till I looked it up. I just knew from watching the games. Yeah, it seemed like he hit a lot of open shots. Then you look it up, and he was like second or third on 82games.com for open jump shots. So to me, that trade was logical, because you play with LeBron, you're going to get open jump shots. And the same thing with Delonte West. Like, he's somebody that was in a lot of bad positions over the course of his career. He was on bad teams. He was playing out of position. And that was somebody that you loved in college and you urged Danny to draft. But he never found the right situation. Then now he's on Cleveland, and he can kind of be Delonte. You know what I mean? It just kind of naturally makes sense for him.
Yeah, I agree. A lot of players play. You know, it's true with Yao as well. He draws so much attention.
Right.
You know, and Delonte is someone that Danny describes it well. He was someone that it was so easy because everyone was unanimous. It was someone. Delonte West, like, you know, Steve Pagliuca was a big fan, you know, who watched a lot of college, and the numbers said he was going to be good. So that's one of the easy ones. The hard ones are when you love a player, but maybe the numbers say he's bad, or the numbers say he's great, but you watch him and you say, yeah, I don't get it. I don't see how he's actually making that contribution.
But now, the thing we always argue about is chemistry. And you were not, maybe you've changed. Now, you weren't as huge on the chemistry numbers thing as much as, like, this guy's good, that guy's good. And we used to argue about this, and we argued before the season. I said, you have too many guys. I don't think these guys are all going to be happy with their minutes. And when we fought about it, and you were like, ah, no, I'm fine. That's never a problem to have too many guys. Now that you look back at it, did you have too many guys?
I don't know. It's hard to say. I do say we're playing our best ball right now.
With a short rotation.
And we executed your strategy not by choice.
And that's, right.
Tracy got had his knee issues and now is out for the year. So we have played our best ball. I do think I listened just like Danny. I learned from that. I listened to everybody, and I do think Popovich, holds your views that the end of the bench you need to have guys who just fit in, don't necessarily. But I'd probably still, I'm stubborn with my beliefs. I'd probably still believe you'd rather have solid players 1 through 15, guys who could step in and contribute at a high level versus just guys who know their place. But that said, and we are playing our best ball right now.
You're into accumulating assets, which I don't disagree with. But you're of the opinion that the more assets you accumulate, the better the chance you could parlay those assets into something else, or you have depth, or you're just in a better position if you have 12 good guys versus 9.
Well, I think that's right. I think that's why Popovich gets to his view. They've got three great players, three top, 20 players in the league. And that's what you need to win the title. I think right now we've got one for sure with Yao Ming. And, I think Ron can play in that area, but he hasn't consistently done that over his career. I think Tracy obviously can play in that area, but he's hurt. So I'd say, we probably still need to have assets to be able to, to trade for. We used a lot of our assets to get Ron, and that's paying dividends now, obviously. I do think, we need assets either who are going to play better, like we're hoping Aaron and Kyle continue to get better, and Landry, or we need to be able to parlay them into a good player. And again, another thing I learned from Danny, he did a great job of that in Boston.
Sports Illustrated wrote a Popovich article. That was one of those things I was so excited to read it, and then obviously they cut the guy's word count or something and ended up not being what it should have been. But he had a great quote in there, and I'm very surprised he said this. Here's the quote. "We get guys who want to do their job and go home and aren't impressed with the hoopla. One of the keys is to bring in guys who have gotten over themselves. They either want to prove that they can play in this league or they want to prove nothing. They fill their role and have a pecking order. We have three guys who are the best players and everyone else fits around them." Kind of fascinating. I'm surprised he shared that.
Well, I think he's been sharing more lately. Maybe he's, just feeling like, hey, there's not many secrets in basketball, because even if you have one, you got to show it on the floor eventually. And,
Yeah, but you guys are all tight-lipped about what you think works. Like, you would never admit one thing that you guys are doing number-wise.
Right. Well, we try to be very careful about it. Obviously, we're making a lot of investment, and every team needs to choose where they're differentiating. And, our ability to maybe identify players and to know, what's going to fit on the floor, we do try to guard that. I think the Patriots have been the best of that of
right.
any sports franchise over the years. And so we try to be careful, which is why it was great to have Mark Cuban on, because usually that panel is like four people who can't say anything.
The basketball analytical panel.
Yeah, the basketball analytics panel. And this year, Mark Cuban is the owner, so he can say what he wants. And, was really open and made for a good discussion, I hope. I mean, I was on the panel, so.
No, I loved it. And God bless Cuban for coming up with this complicated statistical system that somehow proved that Jason Kidd is the second best player in the league. I think when you use stats to just prove that your own guys are much better than people think, I think you've really accomplished something. It was a good job by him. I know you can't say anything, but I enjoyed it.
Yeah, our players turned out are 1 through 10 in the best.
Yeah, you got to come up with some system that makes all of your guys 1 through 15.
Yeah, especially when you're talking about trades.
Right.
I think that would help. Unfortunately, I don't think we can argue that, or we'd be winning every night and not – although we're third in the West now, which is sort of exciting, but I think we're a half game ahead of ninth or something crazy like that.
I actually like your team right now. I like the box scores. I like that eight-man rotation. I only think you need eight guys. I think you get nine, maybe you're pushing it, you get to 10, it's bad. I like having the eight. So you have an eight-man rotation right now.
Clearly you want to have, eight great players and you want to have some separation. I think Coach Van Gundy – was very much an advocate of that. It's hard for a coach when your 9, 10, 11 guys might be as good, because, then guys towards the end sort of push and, you know, say they want to get out there and play. So I do think, just to summarize my thoughts, I think while you need to get better players, I think you need to accumulate assets, and I think we still are in the case where we may need, you know, we may need some players to, you know, be confident in our championship caliber situation, although we do feel very strong about our team right now.
You need one more All-Star.
Yeah, but once you get them, I do think then Popovich's approach of just, you know, making everyone fit into their role makes a lot of sense, because you get rid of all the basically.
Right, and it also helps if you have a franchise guy like Tim Duncan, who is the best teammate in the league and is going to keep everybody in line.
I think. Yeah, that helps.
That helps just a little bit, yeah.
Helps to have him or Garnett, yeah.
You know, do you want to talk about Tracy or no?
I can talk about anything. You're going to have to give you some standard GM answers probably sometimes.
Well, let's go one round. So he announces that he's getting surgery 4 days before the trade deadline. And, you know, there have been rumors you guys were working on trades and stuff with him, potentially, because he wasn't happy and he's got a big contract and whatever. And he basically takes himself out of the trading process at that point and doesn't even tell you guys. He just announces it to the media. What was the reaction internally to that?
Let's not talk about Tracy.
All right, we don't have to.
No, I'd say this. It was I had lunch with Tracy. It was a miscommunication. You know, he was going to see three doctors. We were going to decide what to do at the end of that. You know, after two, the second doctor, who his agent aren't telling him, you know, thinks is the best, basically convinced him it was, you know, he should go with what he did, microfracture. And he was sure. We thought he was still on the plan, so he announced it, and it was a miscommunication.
Were you? I mean, you know, I'm just whatever. You and I talk about this stuff, but I have my opinions, and you have yours. And I personally never felt like the guy was in shape this year. He just looked different to me. He looked doughy, and I don't know what the reason for that was. Since you were in the first round, you got bounced out last year. You need a lot of months to get in shape. He's making $21 million a year. And I'm not a Rockets fan, but as an innocent bystander, the whole thing just seemed weird to me, because this is a guy that really was on pace to have a top 50 career. And the only way that's going to happen is if he bangs out some quality seasons here the last few years, makes the playoffs, wins a couple playoff rounds. And to me, it just didn't seem like he cared that much. Is that a wrong analysis of that?
Well, I think the one thing everyone can agree on is disappointing. I mean, he was the most excited I've ever heard when he heard Ron was coming here, because we felt like we had three great players, and that's generally shown that's what you need.
Yeah.
And, you know, I think he was excited to come into the year, and I think, you know, if he was feeling good, it would have been a very different year, but his knee never cooperated.
So you think his knee from the summer on just was this hanging black cloud over him?
Yeah, and I think some of the conditioning things he said, I mean, he was very upfront about it, that the knee made it hard for him to train. And he did go back and he dedicated himself. And I know for a fact he worked his butt off when he sort of took some time off to try and rehabilitate in the middle of the season. And, you know, he came back strong, but the reality of his injury is each game it got worse and worse. And it just... Yeah, I think the person who feels worse is probably Tracy McGrady. I do think that.
All right. That was very nice political handling of that situation. And he's an expiring contract next year.
He is in his last year. That's right.
Am I going to be making jokes in my column about Tracy McGrady's expiring contract?
You've already promised not to in your last column. So I do.
Well, yeah, I like Eric Dampier. I like the way it just looks.
Last summer it seemed like Yao was the butt of your jokes and how terrible he was, so I'm hoping we can avoid that this year.
You had a chance to trade Tracy a couple times last summer, though, right?
Well, I think you always have a chance to trade a player as good as Tracy. So Detroit did have interest, and it just never worked out for both sides. But, you know, I think, you know, Danny had like eight chances to trade Paul Pierce, but he was smart and, you know, stuck with him. So
he did trade him. It was just Paul Pierce caught wind of it and squashed it.
I'm not. Was that after I left? I'm not familiar with that. But
oh, stop it.
No,
that was
not
reported. They had him traded to Portland for Chris Paul and Nick Van Exel. It was going to be the number three pick, but they would have taken Chris Paul and then Nick Van Exel's contract that was you could waive before the season.
Well, I'd rather not get into the yeah.
I know you can't get into the buses. I'm just saying it's been written about.
You,
it's not like
Dan,
this is.
You have to get Danny on. He can have, you can ask him that.
It's been written about. It's been in the papers and magazines and stuff.
I'm never getting invited back to the podcast. I can tell.
No, I knew you'd do this. You're cagey. Well, tell me about our test. I mean, obviously, I've gotten a lot of mileage out of him comedically. I've always enjoyed watching him play.
Did I get to tell you when we were signing Ron, I watched the brawl again. I think, you know, just in my job, I've got to be totally informed, and mm-hmm. I felt like we need to understand everything about Ron before we made that trade, and so I watched the brawl again, and there's like a really you've missed a real comedic opportunity, I think, with the brawl that you haven't written about, which is when he first laid on the table.
Yeah.
He actually got up before he got the beer tossed on or whatever, and put on the video headset to go on the air during the middle of this.
Yeah.
And Reggie Miller came over and took it off, and so he laid back down again, and then he got the beer thrown on him. So I blame Reggie Miller for the brawl escalating. If he had just let Ron air his problems on air,
it would
never happen.
So
that's why Ron is a misunderstood guy, is what I'm saying. If he had just been allowed to go on the air, it would have been fine.
I like that. So you now blame Reggie Miller for this whole thing. This is good. You have to take that up with him.
Exactly.
Has Ron, in his, how many months has it been? Like 7 or 8 months with you guys? Has he been what you would say, model teammate employee?
He has. Yeah, he really has. I think, you know, for the reasons we thought, he's matured. You know, I think there's his contract sort of in the right place. I think he's with a coach who's great at handling guys like him and him specifically. You know, I think he's on a winning team, which, anytime you're on a winner, I think that makes for better chemistry, obviously. Mm. But he's been great. I mean, I think, you know, he's been everything we've asked. You know, Yao Ming, I think his favorite guy is Ron. He loves guys who play hard, and Ron does that every night, so it's been good.
So he's never showed up for practice just covered in blood? Nothing like that?
He did, but we washed it off quickly.
Just saying, don't ask.
We didn't
I just go take a shower?
We implemented Clinton's don't ask, don't tell when Ron came to Houston, one of the greatest policy strategies in
the
history.
I like that one.
Yeah.
Hey, when you near the trade deadline, you guys were in a unique position because – you know, nobody wanted to take on any money with any trade. So you guys had this, you're in a rare situation because you had all these smaller contracts that could add up to different figures. And the issue that really almost everybody had with making trades was that maybe they were a little interested, but the numbers didn't quite match up. So one team was taking on 700 grand or 1.5 million or whatever, and that ended up being part of what killed the deal. With you guys, you could put together a trade for anything ranging from like 6 million to, you know, 30 million. And you were on the phone all the time, basically, with people saying, hey, what about this? What was that like?
Yeah, we had a lot of flexibility. I think that's right. I think that's one of the things we do indirectly. I don't think you can, I think we plan for it somewhat, but it's not top of our minds. But yeah, we're in the center of a lot of the discussions. I have to say, I mean, it's not the first time, but I was really wrong about this trade deadline. I thought there was going to be a lot of activity. I was really surprised, you know, someone like Rafe LaFrance didn't go somewhere. I thought because there were a big separation between playoff teams and non-playoff teams, and because of the financial situation, that would create a lot of trades, but I didn't anticipate what you wrote about, which is that there's going to be all sellers and no buyers.
Yeah.
And that created, like, you know, maybe the second most boring trade deadline. I think the first one was a few years ago when I was in Boston. It was like 06, and like there was like no trade at all.
Oh yeah, that's right. I forgot about that. Yeah, this was different because really every contender could not have been happy with the team they had. And I wouldn't have even called you guys a contender at the deadline. Now I think you're like a maybe dark horse sleeper long shot contender, but all the teams had a move to make, and none of them did it, and it basically came down to money. It was just weird.
It seemed like it did. Well, I think the other factor that I didn't anticipate was just the GMs just going for home runs.
Mm.
And I think the kid trade and the Gasol trade created that, where, you know, that was sort of the bar that people were trying to hit. And the league's too smart, I think. I hope. The league seems to be getting smarter. I guess it's bad for us, but it does seem to be getting smarter. And I don't think, you know, with Jersey, I think, you know, they were trying to duplicate what they got in that kid trade, which was a lot, and this wasn't going to happen.
So you're saying you miss Isaiah Thomas? dead silence. Okay, so the last 6 hours of the trade deadline, your phone's ringing off the hook. Did you ever have guys, you know, like, hey, so-and-so GM's online. Oh, yeah, put him through. And you just waste your time with like a 5-minute ridiculous trade that you would never do, and it just makes you mad because you have two other guys you needed to talk to.
All the time. Yeah, that's a huge thing that happens. And then the league, I don't think they can find me for this, so I'm going to take some risk here. They're like the bank in the 40s or 20s or whatever. Like they like set the deadline on trade deadline day for 2:00 or 3:00 Eastern.
Right.
You know, the whole league doesn't wake up till 11, even on trade deadline day, unfortunately. So you end up with like an hour and a half to make all these moves. Then they created a new rule this year, which is like, it used to be you could get in the queue to do your trade. And, you know, then they'd call you back like half hour later and you'd finalize it. This year you have to get all parties on the trade at once and recite all the terms before the deadline, which is actually really hard to do in a three-way trade, which actually ended up four-way because there was another executive who had to be on the phone.
Mm-hmm.
So it was like we had to get all that done. And the only reason that they set the deadline early is so they all can go home at like 5:30, I'm convinced. So this is my first campaign to the league to move the deadline and make it easier to get trades done. So part of the reason trades are hard to get done is the league makes it a little bit harder, I think.
God forbid they stay till 5 Eastern to get some stuff done.
Well,
I think a trade deadline should be 10.
I feel good saying this because I talked to several GMs who said they had deals queued up that they didn't get actually done. No, they weren't major ones, I don't think, but there were stuff that teams were trying to get done, and because of the deadline and getting into the queue, they couldn't get it done.
See, when I replaced David Stern as commissioner...
Or Shane Batty, I'm not sure. You're going to have some tough competition for that.
No, I'm going to hire Shane as my assistant. He's going to be my assistant in command.
He's definitely never coming on your podcast now, but okay.
Why not? Because I don't support his candidacy because we're
gonna
rivals
make him,
now.
You're going to make him your assistant.
I thought he was mad at me because I made up a fake trade with him last year, and he thought we were closer than that.
No, he's not mad at you. I think he ragged on Duke once, and that made him mad. But other than that...
No, I hate Duke. I'll rag on Duke right now. Duke
sucks.
He
doesn't mind if you pick on him, but he's very loyal to the Duke program. So.
Oh, I'm going to mail you a picture of me wearing my Duke Sucks t-shirt that I bought for $35 at a vintage store. Right after I'm done, I'm going to email it to you, and you send it to him. Here's my rule that I'd make when I'm commissioner. The trade deadline should be like 5 in the morning. Like, you want to encourage trading. You want these guys to have, like, 3 scotches in them when they're swinging deals. It should be like a fantasy league. These guys should all be, like, half in the bag. They should. Plus, the trade deadline should be during All-Star Weekend when everybody's together.
Yeah,
I would make it 5 in the morning, the Saturday night of All-Star Weekend. That's when the trade deadline should be. And there will be some action. I will tell you that much.
Right, because the goal of the Commissioner League is action, not well-reasoned trades, right?
Yes, I want action. I want action. You know the Ted Williams, Joe DiMaggio
story,
right? You could.
You could own an NBA team, you know.
I'm not wealthy enough yet. I'm almost there.
No, but a lot of owners like action. So I figured.
Oh, yeah. No, I need Subway to increase their sponsorship of this podcast, and I'm in the ballpark. You know, the thing about – you knew about that Joe DiMaggio, Ted Williams trade, right? 1949?
What's that?
The Red Sox owner and the Yankee owner went out, and they got blitzed. And at like 4 in the morning, they agreed to trade Joe DiMaggio for Ted Williams.
What happened?
And they did it. They signed it. No, the next morning they woke up and they were like, "Oh my God, what just happened?" It was like something horrible, and they had to. They basically broke the trade.
Okay.
But at 4 in the morning, that trade was made.
I was like questioning my baseball history. I'm like, like, this didn't happen.
No, that trade was made.
I feel better now that I'm...
I wanted to ask you about, you know, growing up, you grew up in Cleveland.
Yep.
And you love basketball and baseball, right? Those are your
right.
two sports?
That's right.
So statistically, which one did you gravitate toward?
Basketball. Yeah, I mean, it's the sport I played.
Yeah.
So I was very... Now, baseball was something I did a lot with because, you know, if you wanted to do some of the analytics back then, really baseball was the only choice. Like, the basketball statistics weren't available. There weren't any places to go to get data. So, you know, I obviously worked on both, but basketball's always been my first sport.
Well, basketball, you know, it really didn't lend itself to statistics. Even as late, I talked about this with Hollinger when he came on, even as late as 1973, they didn't keep track of steals and blocks, which is just amazing to me. Like, we have no way to measure Bill Russell.
Except all the rings, I guess.
Yeah, all the rings. But, you know, we have a million ways to measure Will Chamberlain. And with Bill Russell, it's like, yeah, he blocked a lot of shots. We have no idea, like, what, you know, what kind of impact he had. But only like the last 7-8 years have the stats become more complex. And the thing that bothers me about what, you know, a lot of these guys are trying to do is they're trying to evaluate players against each other, which I don't think is the future, and you don't either. We think it's more, you know, evaluating players and scenarios and what does this guy do in the left corner when he's open on a three and stuff like that. Like, very specific stats, right?
Well, I think both. I mean, again, in my job, you got to analyze the big ones, which is like, what is this player better than that one? But you're right. When you get down to the winning games level, it's all about, as you say, scenarios. And I'd say the reason why basketball, you know, analytics, you know, have a future is, you know, each time it's very hard. Like, let's take hockey or soccer. There just isn't enough scoring events to tease everything out.
Right.
Each time down the floor in basketball, like, you either score 0, 1, 2, or 3 with some rough probability that each can happen with some frequency. And, you know, that allows you to tease out who's actually creating some value. Like, we're in hockey, you know, there's like, I don't know hockey well enough, but I think the final scores are like 4-3 usually or something like that. So it's hard to tease things out. You can make a great play, but it ends up in a non-scoring event just like a terrible play does most of the time.
Well, that was the question I would have asked during that basketball analytics if the guy with the microphone had ever walked down to where I was sitting.
You were there like a statue. I didn't think you were trying to ask a question.
You know, I actually almost charged the podium at one point when Mark Stein kept talking about the Devin Harris-Jason Kidd trade without mentioning that Dallas also gave up 2 number 1 picks. Like, that wasn't part of the trade, but whatever. The issue to me with basketball stats is this. Baseball is objective. You can prove things in baseball. Basketball, so much of it is subjective, and I think that's the real crisis with how, you know, you can come up with all the stats and formulas you want, but a lot of it you still can't prove. Like, there's no way to... You talked about deflections on that panel, and could we keep track of deflections? Could we keep track of team rebounds, all that stuff? But then... Those are subjective things. Who deflected it? Did it go to his team? Like, I just don't see how it can progress past a certain point. You know what I mean?
Yeah, I think that's right. I think you can't prove it, but that doesn't mean it's not better to do than not do, and that it can improve your decision making. I mean, at the end of the day, that's what you're trying to do. And you can put things in tiers. Like, you can know that, you know, I'll have to go to historic players, but, you know, that... Tim Duncan was better than Marty Conlin, you know.
That's
a terrible example, but I think, you know, there you can put things into tiers, maybe 4 tiers, and know that, you know, that certain players are definitely better. But yeah, can you solve debates like maybe you can in baseball? I do think it's tough to do that with any precision. And the one main thing that I think you make a great point is anyone who's out there saying I've got this great system and it proves that this guy's better than that guy, and anyone who thinks that guy's better than this guy's an idiot, that person's an idiot. Anyone who's talking with any sort of level of confidence in their ability to know what's right, you know, exactly how much someone is worth, is they're the ones that you got to question.
Yeah, unfortunately, I think those people kind of hurt the cause a little bit.
They do. I think there's some folks out there like that, and some that have, you know, gotten some attention, and it has hurt the cause because they do talk with, you know, a level of confidence that isn't really warranted by no one should have that confidence, and probably especially those folks.
You mean if you read a blog post saying that Brent Barry was better than Rick Barry, and then you try to prove it?
I haven't seen that one in particular, but I think
it's out there.
Okay, all right. I know you have some particular ones that drive you nuts, and
you know what? I don't even want to mention them because I don't want to send them traffic. F them.
Exactly.
From the big F.
Exactly.
But the fascinating thing to me about that whole panel is, as you said near the end, somebody asked, you know, because you have all these MIT guys here, there are all these smart guys. They're all looking at you and some of the other people on the panel as kind of heroes. It was kind of weird. In fact, I told our friend Sully, I was like, Daryl's Dork Elvis. He's the Elvis of the MIT guys.
Am I going to die on a toilet from overdose?
You're going to die on a toilet from overdosing on numbers. But you were Dork Elvis. You were surrounded by 30 MIT people at all times. It was amazing to watch.
Now you know why I do the conference every year. I mean,
yeah, it's basically look how great Daryl Morey is conference. You mentioned near the end, somebody asked you what's the best way for me to catch on with an NBA team or break in? And you said, actually, the best way for you to break in isn't just to replicate what everybody's doing, because we all kind of have an idea of where this is going. You need to figure out what the next thing is that nobody's looking at yet. And you suggested, how do you translate the data from European leagues? That's something that nobody's figured out yet.
Right? Yeah, I think that's right. I mentioned China. I don't. If I knew what it was going to be, I'd be on it, frankly. I don't know what it's going to be. But, you know, if you're smart and you've got, you know, what you think is the next big thing that'll help us win in basketball, you know, we'll do it. In fact, if you write to ideas@rocketball.com, you know, it's just a basic email box. We read everything that comes in, and if it's great, you know, you're going to hear from us.
And it seems like if you want to get into sports, you want to, like, potentially running a team, your best chance is to master some sort of cool statistical thing.
I think that was your best bet. You know, probably still is your best, but I think that's right. But I do think the window's closing. I think it might make sense to be the smart guy who figures out how to win at MMA or something, you know, which, you know, maybe that's the next big sport. I don't know what it's going to be, but or go to Europe, as I said, and figure out how to become a big shot over there and then translate that back in the NBA. But the one thing you can't do is, you know, people ask me and I tell them my path, and I gave the short version of it, but it was basically serendipity. I mean, I was looking for opportunities. I was ready to pounce when they came, but I know a lot of talented people who've never gotten the opportunity to even show what they can do. And you just, there's no path. I mean, you know this, Bill. I mean, I don't know. Your path is impossible to replicate, right? You just saw this, you know, sort of, it was even, I don't know, you're on CompuServe or something.
Yeah, Digital City Boston.
Yeah.
Well, I think in your case, it reminds me a lot of Malcolm Gladwell's book Outliers, because, you know, you deserve to get where you got, but also the timing of when you were growing up and went to college and then entered the world, the sports world, all that stuff, kind of coincided with Moneyball and everything else. That opportunity was opening up as you were hitting the point where you were ready for that opportunity.
Yeah, 200 years ago, my family probably stayed in Wisconsin. I'd be improving, you know, pasteurized milk yield, you know. That would have been my family. That would have been great. Like, we'd had a bigger milk farm, but that would have been about it, you know. So, God bless the world. So.
When you read Moneyball, what was your reaction? Were you like, wow?
Wow. I just, well, A, Michael Lewis, unbelievable writer. And B, I was sort of part of it, so it was exciting. Like Rob Nye or Bill James, I worked with.
Yeah.
You know, and so that was cool to get. They had the one chapter on Stats Inc. Basically.
Yeah.
You know, I wasn't in it because I was like the guy sweeping the floor and crap back then. I was in college.
Right.
So actually, my wife and I, we were there, and she always talks about how she was a fantasy phone operator, which she was, because she she was answering the fantasy phone lines late at night after school. So, it was exciting times.
And now, 7 years later, Michael Lewis writes this article about Battier that you're prominently mentioned in on New York Times Magazine. It's kind of cool how that came around.
It was very cool. You know, Michael and I, we met, I'm trying to remember, I think it was at a New Orleans Hornets game, because he was living in New Orleans at the time, and, we were just talking, and he asked about all the players, and I got to Battier, and he just became, you know, he's just got an amazing ability to find a story, you know, and he just was fascinated by Battier. This guy who, like, had no points, no rebounds was somebody I was talking about how great he was, and he was like, this makes no sense. He wasn't a big basketball fan prior to recently, and so he's just like, it just violated everything he had heard from everyone, that those were the players who were good.
It was a cool thing. And as your media advisor, I think now you scale back after Michael Lewis and now this podcast and the Sloan Conference. I think now you dip back for a couple months. You stay out of the spotlight.
I'm honestly not seeking. I'm trying to stay out of the spotlight. You know,
I know. So, I asked you to do the podcast. It's not like you. I'm just saying.
Yeah.
You know, you did a lot of interviews in October, November, and I sent you an email. When is my deli number line up in the interview process? Am I number 59 or 60? And you were like, oh, am I doing too many? It's, you know, because obviously you're a nice guy. You're going to agree to every request.
You are my secret media advisor.
I am.
True.
I'm your secret media advisor.
True.
But, because it's good to get in the spotlight, but at the same time, if your team's on a
we haven't won anything, right?
So, well, also, if you're in like a 12 out of 14 losing streak, all the Rocket fans are like, yeah, that guy doing interviews, he sucks. I hate that guy.
That's coming. There's no doubt. I mean, no matter how successful you are, it's not too far when your team's going to go through a rough patch and we'll all go back to the being idiots again for sure.
So you're thinking you're going to be the 3 seed?
You know what? No one can predict. Anyone who says they with precision they know what basketball players are better, they're wrong. If anyone knows who's going to finish 3 through 7, they have no idea. I mean, it's basically a crapshoot at this point. We feel good how we're playing. That's all I know. But we do have the hardest schedule down the stretch, so I don't think Vegas would have us at the top of the heap for the 3 seed.
Well, you know, the thing that worries me is you've gotten a full season out of Yao, which would be the first time in 4 years.
You're like the announcer announces, this guy has never missed a free
throw. I know. I don't want to be that guy. I'm just saying. That's
he just
worries
threw
me.
That guy. It's too late.
Yeah. I just threw up the graphic. Yeah, first time played, and now he's going to, like, get hit by a car or something.
Yeah.
But I think if you can get him, you know, the way he's been playing, he's in the playoffs, Kyle Lowry gets integrated. Aaron Brooks, a really tough matchup for teams. I don't know. I like the pieces. I'm not sure I'd want to play in the playoffs.
You know, Scola keeps playing better. But Yao, to Yao's point, he's playing the best ball of his career by a good margin. There's one stretch, I think at the start of 2007-08 season, he was playing great. And then this whole year, Yao's just gotten better throughout the year.
Well, the one thing for the people out there to watch for with your Rockets team, you match up really well against teams that are designed against one perimeter scorer who carries a lot of the scoring load. Like, for instance, you played Cleveland on a Sunday, and I remember thinking, wow, they're going to kill Cleveland because they'll take LeBron out of the game. He won't do anything. They have all these guys they can throw on him, and that's what you did. That's why I think if you guys played the Lakers, and I know you can't say anything, you don't want to be a bulletin board GM. So just, I'll do all the talking and you just
well,
meet with
that. Well,
let's
say on your Cleveland point, they also have a, you know, the best matchup for Yao in the league in Ilgauskas.
True.
So I think I would agree with you. We match up well. I'm not saying we're better than them, so I don't end up on the bulletin board. But
it's a rock, paper, scissors league. You're going to have teams that you match up well against. You're going to have teams that you don't.
Right.
And in my opinion, if you guys play the Lakers, and it could be the first round, second round, or whatever, and I'm Kobe Bryant, and I'm looking at a whole game of going against Shane Battier and Ron Artest for two solid weeks, I'm not happy about it. So
it's tough. Those guys, and they're different too. So, like, for a while you get beat on by Ron, and then next thing you know you got Shane, and you can't figure out why, but you keep missing. So it's a good combination. And
You might not win that series, but Kobe's going to have to work his butt off. But then on the flip side, I think a team, you know, like a New Orleans is a tougher, much tougher matchup for you, because a team with a point guard that can do some stuff seems to be like, you know, who knows, but it seems like that
might
be your
case. Yeah, Utah is very tough for us because, you know, Boozer sort of runs wild. Yeah, it was a tough time with him.
Right.
And then I do think, yeah, to your point, New Orleans is a tough matchup, you know, because Tyson's pretty athletic for Yao, you know, and Chris is, you know, a hard guy to handle. So, yeah, you're right.
Well, the Ginobili ankle injury, and it just doesn't look like he's coming back 100%. I think that's just opened that Western Finals spot against the Lakers. And really, I wouldn't be surprised any of the 2-3 teams. I could see anybody making it.
Yeah, I think the real key for us is going to be just where is our go-to ability going to come from? Because that everyone talks about how we're playing great without Tracy, and you know, you guys are better without Tracy, and you know, we are playing better, but that's because we didn't really have Tracy. We had the injured Tracy, but what we've lost with him is, you know, the go-to perimeter player. Because Yao is great. It is, no matter how great of a post player, it's just hard to get a post play in a key situation. You know, it's got to be set up, and that becomes difficult. So, you know, that's where the development of Aaron and Kyle are really important. And, you know, obviously, you know, for a team that's wanting to do a lot, those are younger players. But, you know, young players have been great players on championship teams. So it's not like it hasn't happened before.
Well, you know, I root for you.
Thanks,
Bill. It's sad, but... just because we've gotten to know each other a little bit, and now that Bucher's out at us, I'm always ready for you. I feel like I've written about you guys very fairly, though, and without bias. And in fact,
yeah,
I've swung too far the other way. Yeah.
Okay.
In fact, I've swung the other way. Two last quick things. You're not reading message boards, right? Please tell me you're not reading them.
No, I'm very honest. I read everything.
Oh, my God. Get off the message boards.
Well, I know why you aren't on the message boards. There's some message boards that just crush you. It's awful.
They crush everybody.
Yeah, they crush everybody.
It's one of those things. You just can't look.
Yeah.
And I would advise you not to look.
I know. I did. I'm still in my rookie stages here as GM.
Yeah.
So
don't look. You don't need it.
Out of it.
You don't need
I do. The one that bothers me, though, is GMs will, like, talk to their beat writer and pretend that they haven't read the article in the major newspaper, which I think is laughable because, of course, everybody reads those.
Give me the biggest obstacle against me becoming a GM one day, other than the fact that I have no credibility whatsoever.
You've made everyone hates you, like all the GMs you've crushed, right? Because you don't. I mean, one of the things that and I know I'm blowing smoke, but one of the things that's interesting about your strategy is you don't buddy up with the basketball folks, right? You try and stay more pure, and that way you can write things that others don't write. It sort of differentiates you, but I also think that hurts you within maybe the basketball community, right? Because, you know, you're not, you know, writing three great things about all the executives who might have to hire you someday.
Right.
So I do think that's probably your biggest obstacle. You need to suck up more to, you know, the key basketball folks.
Well, that's not going to happen.
Right. So there's your obstacle.
Yeah, but all I need is one rich reader. All I need is one billionaire reader who gets some sort of family money or something, and I'm in.
There you go. Well, that could happen.
It's just nobody will trade with me will be the problem, because I'll be like, screw you, Simmons. You wrote 2 years ago that I sucked. I will say, though, that I developed a new man crush at your conference.
Oh yeah, with Kevin?
Yeah, Kevin Pritchard, who I have not been kind to. I mean, I haven't taken any personal shots, but I thought he should have taken Durant. I thought he should move the LaFrance contract. But, you know, I've written everything. I think I've written everything fairly. But he turned out to be a really nice guy. And I also learned that he was the point guard on the Danny Manning Kansas team, which I never made the connection somehow.
That's amazing you did.
Yeah.
I guess I should have told. I just assumed.
For some reason, I never made the connection, but he's very congenial. And, now I'm going
to
feel bad when I rip him.
He has to get mad props. I mean, it's like he's made a few mistakes like I have, like, you know, Yeah, but overall, he's done probably the best job of maybe any GM in the last 3-4 years. So
I agree. I think out of the guys from the last 5 years, well, I still think Danny first, probably.
Number one, yeah.
As we discussed, though, or I even wrote about, you know, the Danny thing, if Seattle says yes to that Swift-Jefferson trade, none of this happens. So, you know, it comes down.
But that's true of everybody.
Yeah.
There's all that serendipity. You just got to do the best you can and hope you get a little luck as well. So.
Well, it comes up. There's my phone going off again. This is a professional operation here at the Simmons House. And somehow I have the only phone that actually has a lady telling you who the phone calls from, which is really nice. But, the thing with, as you said, the luck thing, you had that happen with Scola to some degree. You were in the right place at the right time, and they needed to move his salary before he could go back to Europe, and it just kind of happened, right?
Yeah, to me it's no different than career advice they give. You just got to be ready to pounce, but... Yeah, Scola had there's so many factors. Scola had a deadline in Europe where he was going to sign a long deal and be useless to the Spurs. He wasn't the type of player they needed at the time, so they wanted to move him. And a lot of the other teams that were bidding, they weren't able to put together exactly the package the Spurs were looking for, which was, what we could do. We could take on the bad contract they wanted to move. Our owner was willing to put the money in. Mm-hmm. So everything sort of fit, but, you know, could I have planned going to that offseason when my only power forward going into the offseason was Steve Novak? and I love Steve as a person, but he wasn't our plan for the future of the position.
Yeah.
And could I have planned for that? No, but when we saw this opportunity, you know, the owner, to his credit, I said we should do whatever we can to get this guy, and we were able to do it. So
I got to say, with Novak, having been tortured by the Clippers all season in person, I do think he will end up being on a good team at some point in his career and being like a valuable ninth man for them. Along the lines of Jed Bushler with the mid-90s Bulls. There's a spot for somebody like that on the right team who can make threes, and that's all he does.
When we drafted him, we said, worst case, this guy's going to be a great specialist. And I think that's still true. And we thought maybe he could develop into more than that. Clearly, we moved him because we thought that maybe his ceiling was specialist. But, you know, he's a young player who could still got time to prove what he can do.
And that's another thing we agree on. You can never go wrong with a guy who can do one thing really well.
I think it's underrated. Like, you got to do something well, right? Or what the hell are you doing? So that's...
I don't want to make you uncomfortable by talking about other players, but, I go to a Clippers game, and there's one player in particular who seems to carry a particular weight of esteem with the fans who does nothing well. I look at him, and I'm like, this guy has no elite skill.
I'm just not talking about.
The guy's Al Thornton. I watch him, and I'm like, this guy is just never going to make it. He doesn't do anything really, really well. He's going to put up stats because he shoots all the time. He doesn't make guys better. He's not a great defensive player. Every season that they play this guy 35 minutes a game makes no sense to me because I'm not going anywhere with him. On the flip side, somebody like Novak, I'm intrigued by because I could see him on the Greg Popovich Spurs in 2012 as the Matt Bonner. All the, hey, wow, that guy, really? And he all of a sudden he's making big three-point shots. But anyway, we reached the hour mark, and I took too much of your time.
I feel honored, though. I made it into one of these marathon podcasts.
This is good. So. And now you'll be America's new favorite GM. Sloan Sports Conference next year. What is Sloan Sports Analytical Conference?
Exactly. Yeah. Michael Lewis already agreed to be the headliner for next year. So we got a good headliner, and it's just going to get better from there. I got to twist your arm again.
I'll be back. You got to get Gladwell as well. Okay. I invited
Gladwell. He never answered.
He's promoting a book.
Yeah.
Next year we'll get him. And I think, you know, we had a few GMs there this year. I think maybe even more come next year. It could be very uncomfortable for me.
Did you get to make up with Chris Wallace?
You know, I never ran into him.
Oh.
I was like Chris Wallace. He's not good at his job. What do you want from me?
He's a misunderstood guy, and I know he's in your, guy in your rotation for guys you pick on, but
Well, I'll never forget.
Undeserved.
I'll never forgive him for the Vin Baker trade. I just won't, and he can spin it all he want, but he traded for a guy who had a drinking problem.
And right, I'm sorry, bro.
I know, you can't. Yeah, I know, it's awkward. All right, good luck in the playoffs, and thanks for your time.
Thanks, Bill.
Talk to you later. Okay, I wanted to tackle some quick emails before we go. I wrote a mailbag on Friday, which you can find on ESPN.com or sportsguy.net, whatever. Tackled some things in the mailbag that generated just a slew of emails. Here's the one that amazed me. I mentioned how Luke Walton has become the Jennifer Love Hewitt of male, I don't want a sex symbol, I don't know what the word is, but the person that, with Jennifer Love Hewitt, if you tell your girlfriend that you're attracted to her, the girlfriend goes crazy. Just goes nuts. I can't believe this. Oh my God. Like, just gets unnaturally upset about it. And apparently, for men, it's Luke Walton, because somebody suggested this to me. I put it in the mail. It made me angry that Luke Walton is somebody that women find incredibly attractive. Nothing, it's Luke Walton. It's just like, what? Really? Luke Walton? So I put that in a mailbag, and the emails just came pouring in. Two sets of emails. The first kind, people just stunned and angry, equally angry like me. The second kind, from people on the West Coast who either went to college with them in Arizona or are in the LA area now, who could all confirm that not only does Luke Walton do unbelievable with the ladies, but like had stories and no, you have no idea. And apparently Sasha Vujacic does even better. And these guys are friends, so I'll leave it at that. But if you wanted to get angry about Luke Walton before, get really angry now, because this guy does okay. Something else I mentioned in that column. I mentioned that the A-Rod non-trade to Boston was, somebody asked me if that was the biggest non-trade ever, and I said that. I mentioned, which we just talked about in the podcast, Al Jefferson, Robert Swift, that the fact that Seattle didn't do that trade ended up winning the Celtics the championship. So I thought that was the biggest Boston trade. I wasn't really sure of the other sports, so people emailed in. Somebody pointed out the Spurs almost signed Jason Kidd, and then we're going to trade Tony Parker for him. I don't remember the exact details of that, but I'm sure if they had gotten Kidd, they probably would have traded Parker. I'm going to say that worked out. The one I forgot, and I actually didn't forget it, but I had my years wrong. I thought this was 97, but it was actually before the 95 season. Scottie Pippen for Sean Kemp was like almost a done deal. And one of the teams backed out. The Bulls kept Scotty. Jordan came back. They didn't win the title that year, but the next year they won, and then they won the next two. So they won three titles because that trade didn't happen. So as far as I'm concerned, that might be the second most significant trade ever. Joe Mead, do you like that one?
It's a good one.
Yeah. Thanks for your input, as always.
Absolutely.
I mentioned this somewhere, but the Robert Horry trade, where the Rockets tried to trade him for Sean Elliott. Elliott failed the physical. The Rockets kept him and won back-to-back titles. That was a good one. I don't think that had quite the impact of a Pippen Kemp trade. A couple of Philly fans emailed that Ryan Howard was apparently traded almost twice. Once for Kip Wells, and then another time for Chris Benson, both to the Pirates. And it was because Jim Tomei was the starter, and they just decided they wanted to get something for Ryan Howard. And both times, the Pirates GM, David Littlefield, shot down the trade. That's a pretty good one, because they end up winning a title. Then there's another one. The year before the Sixers made the finals, the Pistons had a done deal for Allen Iverson. And it was like a four-teamer where Allen Iverson ended up in Detroit. But Matt Geiger needed to rework his contract for it to work, and wouldn't do it. He refused. So trade fell through. Iverson made the finals. The Pistons had to go to Plan B, which turned out to be Ben Wallace, Richard Hamilton, and Chauncey Billups. That's a pretty good one. But here's the best one. Joe Mead, you ready?
Let's do it.
It's baseball. Happened in 1996. What do you think?
And it has to do with the Red Sox or Yankees?
The Yankees. I'm just going to tell you.
Let's do it.
The Yankees almost traded Mariano Rivera for Felix Fermin. And the trade was almost done and somehow fell through. And then Rivera became Rivera, and they won 4 World Series with them, and now he's the greatest closer in baseball history. That's a good one. I don't think we're topping that one. Do you agree?
That might be the one, although I don't want to talk about the Yankees like they... Rivera, overrated.
Oh. I hate the Yankees, but even I have to admit he's pretty good.
Yeah. He's okay, but are you really that afraid of him when the Red Sox are down by 1 in the ninth against him?
Well, the Red Sox do well against him. I think that's a bad example. I think the rest of the league has been pretty good. Hey, there's an email about Joe Meade.
All right.
This was written from Terry in the Bronx after you had to do the new opening for my podcast with Jacko because there was an update with the A-Rod hip thing.
Yeah.
After hearing Joe Meade give the new opening about A-Rod's hip on your recent Jacko podcast, it has become apparent that Joe Meade just dislikes you. In these remarks, he was alert, upbeat, and sounded great. However, when he makes remarks while you're doing your podcast, he sounds tired and annoyed. Nonetheless, more Joe Meade. So I don't know, that was like a backhanded compliment?
I guess. Well, I mean, I did this high energy thing on your podcast, so I mean, that is for you.
You need to let people know that you actually do like me.
I do.
Okay.
I mean, you know, it's not a full-on bromance, I guess, but...
It's a bromance in waiting. A couple more. Joel from San Francisco wants to know where I stand on the Dennis debacle in this season's high school reunion. He writes, I mean, this guy is clearly an alcoholic and crossed some serious lines, and I wouldn't want to hang out with him. However, I understand why his friends are standing up for him. I don't think I could boot my best friends from a situation like that. It's really quite the conundrum, isn't it? I imagine what it's like... Or imagine the same thing happened in the Cowboys' locker room the last few years. Interesting point, and that really tells you all you need to know about my feelings on Buffalo signing of Terrell Owens, is that I agreed with the comparison of Terrell Owens and Dennis the alcoholic from high school reunion. So there you go. Also in that mailbag, Tim from Garwood said that I should have compared the total recall chick to the girl with three boobs, to Antonio Alfonseca, the six-fingered reliever. I should have thought of that. It's a bad job by me. I got a lot of Ray LaMontagne emails because he apparently was the singer on SNL. Now, I didn't know this because I had my SNL TiVo settings to save the last two, and on Sunday night they decided to run two of those rehashed, repackaged SNL parody specials or whatever they do, and they bumped off Saturday night's telecast. So I've never seen it. Thank you, NBC, for... yet another way of antagonizing your viewers. Here are two emails that I thought summed up everyone's feelings. This is from Sal in Chicago. I just saw Ray on SNL, and this guy needs to be stopped. All I need is another guy who thinks, or all I need is another guy that my wife thinks is more sensitive than me. Please keep spreading the word on this guy. Okay. Second, from Karp in South Vienna. Oh my God, I have read about this guy in your column and have now seen the poop that spews from his mouth. It's a great night when your girlfriend passes out from too many Jaeger Bobs and leaves you to a night of online poker. And then I thought, hey, The Rock is on SNL and that should be entertaining. And then I see Ray as the musical guest. You warned me of the train wreck, but I couldn't turn away. My ears have now been raped. Can we please get Ray a ticket on Oceanic Air with a special flyover pedophile? We'll work on it. Joe, did you see it?
I didn't see it. I taped it and I did not erase it with the Sunday broadcast, but I have yet to watch it.
Well, I'm going to try to stop him. I'm going to do my best, even if this leads actually having him on a podcast. But I'm glad at least other people have now been tortured by him.
Maybe he could come in live in studio and play us a new song or something.
Maybe he could sing that You Are So Beautiful song to me. And then the last thing I wanted to mention is that I feel like somebody should... I know there are bands out there and, you know, we can send them some traffic if they come up with stuff like, you know, we did with Theocracy when they wrote the song about Jacko. I feel like there should be a song that somebody should write specifically for the podcast set to the lyrics of Oh Sherry by Steve Perry, but it would be called Oh Johnny and it would be about A-Rod's hip surgery. Just a complete song just where you take the lyrics and you twist them around for Oh Sherry. I would enjoy that. We would play it. We'd send bands to you. We'd send traffic to your website. Everybody wins. So let's see who wants this. Until later on the BS Report, Bill Simmons signing off.
target. That's not all. Whoa.
Thank you for downloading the BS Report with Bill Simmons.
Too much fun.
Check out more podcasts at the iTunes Music Store or at PodCenter at ESPNRadio.com.
Peace out.
And that concludes another episode of the BS Report. And here's 55 more words that Bill Simmons intended to mention, but unfortunately ran out of time. Now you can get any regular piled high Subway footlong for just $5. The keyword is any. The sweet onion chicken teriyaki, savory chicken and bacon ranch, the meaty taste bud pleasing Italian BMT. All the regular famous Subway footlongs, just $5. Subway, eat fresh. See store for details.